Good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, two cabinet members of Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. resigned from their posts.
The Philippine police believes there's a high probability the killing of veteran broadcaster Percy Labit was work-related.
The Supreme Court issues a show-cause order against former Anti-Insurgency Task Force spokesperson Lorraine Badoy for her remarks against a Manila judge. We'll get the reaction of Attorney Rico Domingo of the Movement Against Disinformation.
And former U.S. President Donald Trump asks the Supreme Court to intervene in the legal tussle involving classified documents that he kept at his Florida home.
Thanks for joining us. Barely 100 days since assuming office, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has lost three cabinet officials. Malacanang says Press Secretary Trixie Cruz Angeles resigned on Tuesday due to a medical condition. Cruz Angeles did not disclose her condition, but she told members of the press that while it isn't serious, it is still needed to be addressed. Her replacement has not been announced yet. Meanwhile, Executive Secretary Lucas Bersamin also confirmed that Commission on Audit Chairman Jose Calida has also stepped down from his post. Calida, who was Solicitor General under the previous Duterte administration, was among the 15 Marcos appointees bypassed by the Commission on Appointments.
He tendered his resignation partly for many reasons, but it's up to him to later explain to you or publish to you what were his reasons, but we accepted that with regret and we commended him for his patriotism also, for serving for a short while.
Bersamin also clarified the status of his predecessor, Attorney Vic Rodriguez, who earlier announced that he has been appointed as Presidential Chief of Staff through an administrative order supposedly signed by President Marcos himself. But Bersamin denies that there is such a document.
To our knowledge, wala. Ang totoo niyan, eh, kung meron talaga, ililitaw natin kung meron. But up to now, wala pang lumilitaw na ganyan. We do not even talk about it. He is no longer a member of the cabinet. You must recall that he resigned for a specific reason. And that reason is well published to you. No? We cannot second guess that reason.
Meanwhile, Marcos has reappointed other cabinet members who were bypassed by the Commission on Appointments due to lack of time. Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno, Public Works Chief Manuel Gonoan, and Social Welfare Secretary Irwin Tunfo were among those who attended the oath-taking ceremony in Malacañang on Tuesday. The Information and Communications Technology Department says Secretary Ivan Uy failed to attend the event because he is out of the country. As for the Commission on Elections, it says it's awaiting word whether Marcos will reappoint Poll Commissioner Nelson Celis.
A fall from grace, that's how some political analysts describe the exit of several of President Marcos's cabinet members. Citing recent controversies they were involved in, former Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez was linked to the sugar importation mess and was even subpoenaed to a Senate hearing to answer for his role. Trixie Cruz Angeles also drew flak for seemingly trying to keep the president's F1 trip in Singapore a secret, despite photos already emerging online showing he attended the event. Analysts Armandine Nokom and Rogelio Panao believe this may be the reasons why they were eased out of their posts.
Nakikita natin parang meron realignment. This could be a plus factor sa taong bayan. Pwede yung magic ni bagong Executive Secretary Bersamin is working, na gumaganda na yung vetting of applicants for positions. Yung kaya Attorney Vic at saka kay Attorney Trixie, clearly fall from grace yun, kasi alam naman natin si Attorney Vic, basically siya talaga yung mukha ni, hindi naman very accessible si Bongbong nung campaign, pero si Attorney Vic talaga nandyan. Pero during the course of his appointments, may mga sublight, nagiging pabigat na sila sa gobyerno.
Ginagamit siya para ma-minimize yung tawag ng moral hazard kung questionable yung mga naunang appointments. Halimbawa po, hindi katanggap-tanggap sa mga tao. Or halimbawa, yung na-appoint, meron siyang halimbawa sa hindi kagandahan halimbawa sa pagtanggap ng mga tao, makaka-apekto sa administrasyon, Kaya nga, alba, political, yung commission appointment. Huwag ko natin kalimutan na nasa honeymoon stage pa rin itong Pangulo. Kailangan nito mag-build ng trust po at saka syempre yung semblance na may capacity ito na dalhin ang ating bansa no, sa kanyang mga plano.
In other news, the Supreme Court issues a show cause order against former Anti-Insurgency Task Force spokesperson Lorraine Badoy. She's ordered to explain why she should not be cited in contempt of court over statements against Manila Judge Marlo Magdoza Malagar. Badoy accused the judge of lawyering for the Communist Party of the Philippines and its armed wing, the New People's Army, after ruling that rebellion and political crimes are not acts of terrorism. She's given 30 days to submit her explanation. Let's now get the reaction of Attorney Rico Domingo, the chairman of the Movement Against Disinformation. They filed, actually, Attorney Domingo is one of those who filed a petition yesterday to cite Badoy in indirect contempt before the Supreme Court. Good morning, Attorney Domingo. Welcome back to the program.
Thank you, Mike. Good morning, and Nikki. Good morning, and good morning to the listeners as well.
All right, Attorney Domingo, let me begin with your reaction to the show cause order issued by the Supreme Court yesterday, giving Lorraine Badoy 30 days to explain why she shouldn't be cited in contempt. The Supreme Court briefer made clear it was issued by the court on its own initiative, although it acknowledged statements coming from Hukom, a group of trial court judges, and the faculty of the UP College of Law. What do you make of this development?
That is a very welcome development, Mike, because we believe that the court is very serious about this. And the Honorable Chief Justice had always been very, very emphatic about his concern and his court's concern about what's happening and the postings of former Undersecretary Badoy. And we welcome that. And in fact, we have also received words that our petition that we just filed yesterday morning, where you were there as well, have been docketed as GR number 263384. So it means that the court had already taken cognizance of our petition.
Mm-hmm. We'll get to that in a bit, Attorney Domingo, but explain to us how the Supreme Court works. Because normally, we talk about the Supreme Court, the court will usually just wait for a petition to be filed before acting on it. But in this case, it chose to move on its own initiative. It first issued a warning last week. Now it issued a show cause order. Is this indicative of the importance that the magistrates place on this issue?
Definitely, Mike. This is actually indicative of the great concern the Honorable Court has given to this particular over this particular issue that had been going around and had triggered a lot of reactions, very negative reactions from the legal groups as well as all the public. No? So in other words, they have given this a transcendental importance and therefore they have given this a sui generis type of treatment and this unprecedented. And the court will go and make this already a full bore inquiry. And that's why it issued yesterday, I think, a show cause order against Undersecretary or former Undersecretary Badoy Partosa.
Mm-hmm. And Attorney Domingo, how significant is the language of the High Court? And let me quote, in contempt of the judiciary and therefore of this court, referring to the Supreme Court. Normally, when we talk about the contempt order, usually it just says in contempt of court. So the fact that it says in contempt of the judiciary and it listed issues that seems to be a list of issues for oral arguments.
Yes. Definitely, because actually the court has determined that it is actually a contempt of the entire judicial system. Mm-hmm. It's not only the court, the RTC court, in concerned about this, Judge Malagar. It is the entire Supreme Court, the entire judicial system, the entire third branch of the government. And therefore, this is a very, very serious matter for the Honorable Supreme Court. And
what
that
about
is exactly what we wanted to be addressed also in our petition.
What about the list of issues that it wants Baday to comment on? Among these were issues on freedom of expression, free speech. And in fact, one of the questions being asked, does Baday consider her statements part of protected constitutional speech? What's the indication of this particular Shokos order? Of course, I cannot ask you to comment whether her speech violates or is part of protected speech, but the fact that the Supreme Court wants her to comment on this, what's your reading?
Well, the background of that is that there have been a long list of cases, decided cases by the Honorable Supreme Court, that would recognize the right of the public to comment and have critical evaluation of the courts and the judges, including those pertaining to actual litigated matters. But the court had always been very, very clear that any criticism should not spill over the bounds of decency and propriety. And this is the fourth issue in that show cause order is actually addressed to that particular portion. No, because the court had also been very, very consistent that free speech is not unfettered. Indeed, it's not unlimited. In other words, you have to have a show, you have to show that it is something that is very pertinent to the matter that is at issue. And at the same time, you should be using language that is not false. And the court had always been very consistent that any falsehoods or false lies should not be countenanced by it. That's why it put the former undersecretary on the spot here because of her posts in the social media.
And so in short, when the Supreme Court says you comment on this issue on freedom of expression or free speech, whether your statements are protected, is the Supreme Court saying that, yes, you can criticize, but it should be within the bounds of freedom of expression? Therefore, in the context of contempt proceeding, is it providing this opportunity to Ms. Baday to prove whether her speech is actually protected, providing her a defense, possibly?
Definitely, because as you know, Mike, being a lawyer, this is actually a criminal contempt proceeding. In other words, there should be due process. As opposed to or compared to the direct contempt, which is summary, a criminal contempt should give the defendant or the respondent the right to due process. In other words, this part of the due process that the Honorable Court would like to extend to the former Undersecretary Pardoza.
And one of the issues, though, that some lawyers' groups are raising before the Supreme Court, the issue of red tagging, there's no mention of that, just inciting violence towards judges. What do you make of that?
Well, it's a matter of terminology. If you put everything in context, all the posts of the respondent would say self-explanatorily what she wanted to say. So it's all the court now is for the Honorable Court to decide whether it is actually contumacious as to merit or to warrant a citation for contempt.
Now, given the issuance of the Shokos order, how will this affect the filing of your indirect contempt petition yesterday? You did mention there's already a GR number, so therefore the court is taking cognizance. But in terms of how the court will treat that petition, what's your take?
My take, Mike, would be I would hope that our petition would be consolidated with the AM of the Honorable Supreme Court. And they would be adjudicated together because we provided concrete ironclad evidence showing that the respondent would have to answer for the petition. In other words, we have provided all the concrete postings as annexes to our petition, and there's really no need for additional evidence for that, because under the electronic evidence rule, they can be admissible already as evidence. So there's really nothing that we can present anymore, except, of course, to traverse whatever the respondent would like to say in her comment after an inextendable 30 days.
But what prompted you to file the petition in the first place, Attorney Domingo? Because you already knew that there is a pending administrative case before the Supreme Court. So why the need to file another petition?
We are actually echoing very, very definitely and emphatically the voice of the legal community. If you will recall, all the petitioners are lawyers. And we would like to dramatize and to highlight the fact that whenever we are called upon as officers of the court we will be delving with these issues that have been posed in our petition. And we want the Honorable Supreme Court to recognize that we are here helping the court to preserve the independence of the judicial system, which we are the officers of the court of. Mm-hmm. So in other words, we would like to show to the public that we are here to defend the independence of judiciary and to preserve the dignity and authority of the Supreme Court.
Mm-hmm. But the big question, Attorney Domingo, is the question of standing, legal standing, because none of you are judges. None of you have been subjected to Baday's threats, at least with respect to this issue. Do you think the Supreme Court will consider the standing of lawyers or deans of colleges of laws to challenge these actions of Baday?
We would hope that the Supreme Court will revisit its previous jurisprudence. Mm-hmm. And the Honorable Court had always been consistent that it can actually disregard technicalities and admit us as petitioners and would provide us the locus standi for this purpose. We believe our petitioners, we believe that we have the locus standing because we are officers of the court who are here to protect the integrity and the independence of the judicial system, which is the Supreme Court is at the apex of the judicial system and should be able to preserve that particular independence.
Mm-hmm. And what about the doctrine of hierarchy of courts, that you were able to go straight to the Supreme Court when there are other courts which could probably grant your remedy?
Well, we can cite the transcendental importance of this, mm-hmm. and that the Honorable Court should set a precedence that any future attempts to undermine, to degrade, to obstruct justice, and to challenge and defy the dignity of the Honorable Court will not be countenanced. That is exactly what the essence and the crux of our petition.
Attorney Domingo, to an average viewer, explain to us why this is a crucial petition before the Supreme Court. Because people outside may just say, so what if Baday made these statements? So what if Baday made a hypothetical syllogism, as she said in her defense? Why should the average viewer or citizen care about this issue pending before the Supreme Court?
We cannot trifle with the resolutions or decisions of the judges. You cannot hurl invectives or insolent statements against the judges, because otherwise the judges would be intimidated. In the future, they will not be able to adjudicate court cases as freely as they would, depending on their assessment and evaluation of the cases that are given before them. Mm-hmm. So this is exactly the danger, the imminence of that. Because if anybody can criticize the court with falsehoods and lies, then what would happen to our judicial system? What would be the dignity and authority of our judicial system that we're trying to protect? It will be chaos, as I mentioned to you yesterday during the press conference. Kaguluhan yan. Nobody will respect the court. And everybody can probably, who heard those lies and believe them, will say that the courts are nothing. Right now, our court, there is a siege. There is a challenge to the court's integrity and authority right now. And you can see that in the trolls. When we filed the petition, you can see the trolls. They said that we are just publicity seeking. That's exactly the kind of reaction that we're getting to some people in the public. That's why there's already an erosion on the dignity and the trust of the people on the justice system. They don't believe anymore. Some of them do not believe anymore in the justice system, that they cannot get any decision resolutions from our judges, from our courts. That is what we're trying to preserve in our petition.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Attorney Rico Domingo is the chair of the Movement Against Disinformation and the immediate past president of the Philippine Bar Association.
Thank you very much, Mike. Thank you, Ricky. Good morning to all. Good morning to all.
The National Police believes there's a high probability the killing of veteran radio broadcaster Percival Mabasa, popularly known as Percy Lapid, was work-related. Lapid was a staunch critic of President Marcos and his predecessor, Rodrigo Duterte. He was shot twice in the head by two armed men on Monday while on his way home to Las Piñas.
Highly probable po na doon po sa kanyang profession yung tinitignan. Nakita nga po natin na walang plate number yung sasakyan at nakita na at that time madilim po at yung pag-execute ay yung pagbaril mismo, dalawang putok lang ay tapos umalis na. Kasama po sa backtracking kung ano po yung naging sa komentaryo o sa mga programa po ng ating Percival po, ay yun po ang tinitignang anggulo kung ano yung mga naging komentaryo at naging nasabi o doon sa kanyang broadcast program.
Authorities are now hoping to get more details about the incident through a copy of the dash cam recording of Lapid's vehicle.
Yung recovery po ng car dash cam po ay atin pong pinoprocess na para po sa pagkatapos po ng download, pag-downloading po nito, makita po natin yung totoo at yung malinaw na pangyayari. Naka-on po yung dash cam at nare-record po lahat ng mga nakukuha na niya.
A special task force has already been formed to look into Lapid's killing. Malacañang says it expects to receive an investigation report in 7 days.
Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos also vowed justice for the killing of broadcaster Percy Lapid. In a statement, Abalos said government will not turn a blind eye to the Heinous Act. He says his agency and the PNP are committed to bringing the perpetrators behind bars. Abalos adds the DALG will continue to strive to protect media practitioners as he recognized their role as watchdogs and as the government's partners in information dissemination. Condemnation and calls for justice in the Philippines following the ambush slay of broadcaster Percy Lapid, the presidential palace ordering a probe into the incident. We have this report.
The remains of radio broadcaster Percy Mabasa has been brought to the Manila Memorial Park.
Ano po, makamit namin ang justisya sa pagkawala. Sa mapili sa pagkawala ng amin, ng ama ng aming sa buhay. Sapagkat anim po kaming mga anak niya na naulila sa pagmamahal ng isa. Kaya sana po, tulungan niyo kami na makamit ang justisya at ipaglaban ang mga gusto niya pang ipaglaban.
Roy Mabasa is shocked by the death of his brother Percy. He is the third among 7 siblings. Both Roy and Percy followed the footsteps of their father, Marcelo Mabasa, a radio commentator. The brothers joined the field of radio broadcasting back in 1984. Roy eventually shifted to print journalism while his brother stayed on as radio commentator.
Hindi ko ma-imagine na siya, but you know, wala akong magagawa eh. Percy is really a very high caliber commentator. Sad pero alam mo, parang may premonition ako eh. I thought this could happen to him.
Known to his audience as Percy Lapid, he is a known critic of the Duterte and Marcos administrations. Before he was brutally murdered, Lapid talked about the issue of red tagging in his program in DWBL. Roy said he last saw Percy during his birthday party last month. His brother did not mention anything about receiving death threats. In Quezon City, the National Union of Journalists of the Philippines held an indignation rally. The group condemns the killing of Lapid. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has expressed concern over the killing of Lapid. In the meantime, the Foreign Correspondents Association of the Philippines has condemned the killing, adding that Mabasa's murder underscores the threats and risks Filipino media workers continue to face in the country. The Commission on Human Rights says it is already conducting a motu proprio investigation into the deadly ambush. The CHR adds it stands with the media community in denouncing what it calls a violent crime and violation of right to life.
The brazen killing of Filipino broadcaster Percy Lapid is condemned by at least 3 countries. The Netherlands and Canada call for an urgent probe on the killing of the radio commentator. They warn that media killings create a chilling effect that could prevent journalists from reporting the news freely. The Dutch and Canadian embassies lead the Local Media Freedom Coalition in the Philippines, a global network of countries pledged to defend press freedom. The French embassy also expressed in solidarity with Lapid's family. In a statement, Paris reaffirmed its commitment to press freedom and the protection of journalists.
For more on the probe into the death of Percy Lapid, we are joined on the line by Undersecretary Joel Eggo. He was the first executive director of the Presidential Task Force on Media Security. I understand he is still involved with PITI forms. Good morning, Undersecretary Eggo. Welcome back to the program.
Yes, good morning, Tony Mike. And good morning po sa lahat po ng ating mga kababayang who's watching us right now.
Yes, Eko, we just want to get some updates first. What's the status of the investigation right now by PITI forms? Any leads, any additional details that you can provide us?
Well, only last night I was on the phone with Colonel Jaime Santos, no, the Chief of Police of Las Piñas City. And we are also in close coordination with the PNP Media Vanguards, no, led by no less than General Roderick Alba. So we get parang blow-by-blow account dyan. And the last information that I got from Colonel Santos that they're working on some persons of interest already. But of course, it requires further investigation. And all of us, no? All of us are on our toes. So we keep, we keep each other in the loop. No, in fact, we have a very active Viber group with the Media Vanguards now, no, with General Alba. So I hope this turns into something good, no, and hopefully magkaroon ng breakthrough, no, in the coming days. Hopefully.
Yusek Eggo, are we able to determine now if the killing was work-related in relation to his work as a radio commentator, knowing that he has been critical of several government figures?
Ever since, no, it has always been our policy, no. Even when I first started as the executive director of PITI Forms, I'd like to clarify lang, Tony Mike, no, I'm officially I'm technically on leave, and the OIC now of PITI Forms is Attorney Perry Solis, but I continue to provide them guidance, no, on a day-to-day basis, no. So as to whether or not the killing of Percy Mabasa, who is I worked with Percy a few years back, ano, it's a matter of policy that we consider the case as work related, so that we can step in and conduct of course our own investigation into that killing, which we condemn, no, in the strongest terms.
So would you say, sir, that this killing, which happened in Las Piñas, within Metro Manila, is brazen compared to the other killings that you have monitored at PITI Forms? Because I understand that one of the points that you've raised previously is that most of the radio commentators or journalists killed are in the provinces. But now it's happening in Metro Manila.
That's a good observation. In fact, I'm enraged. I'm so angry about it. That's something that is very personal to me. Besides knowing Percy personally and having to work with him in the past, no, this is for the longest time, no, the first in so many years that an incident like this happened in NCR, no. So I'd like to point out that on the inventory of PITI Forms, there are since 1986, I guess, around 7 or 8, no, cases of media killings, and for the longest time, this is the only time, no, again, that it happened here. So it's a challenge for us. Again, I'm enraged.
But beyond being enraged, Yusek, how alarming is this for media practitioners, even in the capital, those who have a huge following? Because Mr. Lapid has a huge following online, sure, and even on radio. For someone of that stature to be easily targeted and to be easily killed in one of the busiest places in the entire Metro Manila.
Yeah, I'm both enraged and alarmed. I agree with you. That's alarming. So, you know, it requires now a deeper, no, look into the status of our friends in the media here in the capital region. So I'll be meeting again with the group of General Alban. Also, we have hundreds of media security vanguards all over the country. But we're going to call for a meeting with the vanguards here in the National Capital Region. So I agree with you.
Have you been able to determine, Yusek, if Mr. Lapid received threats, whether online or through her through his personal devices, threats coming from anyone?
The cell phone of Percy is now forensic investigation is now being done, no? Doon sa kanyang cell phone. And so far, I spoke with some of his friends, no, including his lawyers, Attorney Toto Kausing, who broke the news, no, that night. Wala naman eh, no, so far. But yung days leading or weeks leading to his death, it seemed wala namang ganong indication. And,
his uncle was reportedly saying that Mr. Lapid received death threats. Have you been able to talk to him?
The uncle?
Yes.
Ah, okay. So I'll
a relative by affinity, relative. Go ahead. Sir.
But you know, I heard Roy Mabasa, who was president of the NPC before, and I served Roy, no, under Roy, many years ago. And I, you know, I'm going to speak to Roy Mabasa, no, within the day, and find out, no, who may have been, you know, sending those threats to Percy. But of course, in deference to the investigation being conducted by the PNP, and I believe the NBI also is stepping in. So, tayo na lang natin.
Mm-hmm. Lastly, Yusek, what kind of protection will you be extending to the family of the slain broadcaster?
Automatic yan. So the PNP is already securing the family, no? And tuloy-tuloy po yan, just like what we used to do, no? Ever since. So yan ang ano natin, Attorney Mike. Of course, we secure the family. We have to secure the family.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, Yusek Joel C. Echo.
Yes. Thank you.
Executive Secretary Bersamin defends President Marcos from criticism. Taxpayers' money was used to fund his recent trip to Singapore. Marcos had attended the Formula One Grand Prix last weekend with several members of his family and their friends. Bersamin says, "There's nothing wrong with that, as the administrative code affords great importance and value to the welfare of the first family." The former Chief Justice also dismissed criticisms that the trip was insensitive and unnecessary, as millions of Filipinos continue to reel from the effects of Typhoon Carding. Bersamin insists the president is entitled to his own private time.
Let's assume na private time niya yon, kasi he chose to go there for a specific purpose na manood, yun ang primary niya, no? But he could go there also for other purposes, equally important. Oh, you may not call that a state visit, but nonetheless, it is not any less covered by that law issue. It's not relevant at all to question, to ask kung kinong gumastos.
National ID.
Marcos had described his unannounced visit to Singapore as productive, saying that attending the F1 race was the best way to drum up business for the country. But activists have urged the administration to be more transparent about the details of the trip, especially if the Filipino people are the ones footing the bill.
We're taking a quick break. Up ahead, former U.S. President Donald Trump asked the Supreme Court to intervene in the legal tussle involving classified documents that he kept at his Florida home.
And a Philippine lawmaker wants the chief of the Philippine Statistics Authority, chief, replaced amid delays in national ID project. These are more than the rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to The Rundown. Another grim forecast for the world economy. The United Nations Conference on Trade and Development again slashes its global growth forecast. They expect global economic growth this year to hit just 2.5%. In March, the organization already reduced its growth projection from 3.6% to 2.6%. The UN now urges central banks to loosen their belts to avoid a global recession.
The Philippine government set to roll out a printable version of the national ID amid the delays in the release of physical cards. The Philippine Statistics Authority Chief Dennis Mapa says 8,000 registrants have so far received their electronic PHIL IDs under a pilot test in Metro Manila and nearby provinces. He adds the program will soon be expanded across the country. But Mapa says the electronic version of the national IDs can only be printed in accredited registration centers. The release of the physical cards has figured in delays attributed to the limited printing capacity of the PSA. President Marcos in July also ordered the fast-tracking of the cards' release. And a Philippine lawmaker wants the chief of the Philippine Statistics Authority replaced amid delays in national ID project. Let's talk more about this with Senior Deputy Minority Leader and Northern Samar Representative Congressman Paul Dazan. Good morning, sir. Thank you so much for joining us.
Good morning, Nikki.
All right. So, Congressman, let's start off with out of the more than 70 million who have registered, we have only 21 million so far who have received their physical national IDs. What are the reasons behind this delay in ID deliveries for several years past?
Nikki, first of all, I think we made a mistake. PSA and BSP made a mistake. The trend all over the world is to have digital IDs. So what should have been done, because there's about 80 million Filipinos with phones, and most of us have smartphones. So we made a critical mistake. In fact, not digress tayo. We should have had digital IDs. Mm-hmm. And then siguro optional, the printable or the old type of IDs. Mm-hmm. Second, they've had implementation delays. Congress has set aside or funded at least 20 billion since 2018. They've used about 6 billion pesos. Mm-hmm. There's no reason to be delayed. We've funded the project. So there's problems with PSA and BSP. And that's what needs to be shared with the public. Ano ba talaga yung problema nila? And that's why I called in during the budget hearing. We found out that the deputy national statistician, the second in charge in PSA, had resigned or retired. I think it's now the best time for the cabinet to find someone who can fix all of this, because appointed, that's that person's appointed by the president. So the president should now appoint someone to head, because the former head apparently retired. And we should find someone who can fix all of this.
So this is a problem inherited by the current administration. Final, we're talking years of delay in the issuance of national IDs. Do you agree that this underscores now more than ever the urgent need to file a PSA replacement plan?
Yes. In fairness to President Marcos, he got this problem from before, but there are some major personalities who were involved before, who are still with the administration. The DOF Finance Secretary, Ben Jokno, was what I remember the BSP head. And BSP was part of this in 2018. So Secretary Jokno should be able to be honest with the president and give a honest background on what's happened with this project. The other thing I think should be done, the president should order a contract review and then share that with the public. Diba? Because ito talagang delayed and we funded it, there's money available, then maybe the best thing is to terminate the contracts. that they should take a look into that, terminate the contract, and then fix all of this going forward.
Mm-hmm. And the delay in the delivery of IDs for several years now is reportedly the very reason nga po, as said kanina, that former NEDA chief Ernesto Pernia was removed. And yet the problem still persists. You know, we've had different heads of the PSA now. Why is this the case?
That's the mystery to all of us. That's why I think part of the reason you're interviewing me was I made a big fuss about this during the budget hearing of the NEDA, because PSA is within the NED, is an attached agency within NEDA. So I interpolated about the status of this project, and I questioned the budget, because for 2023, we're again allocating over 2 billion pesos mm-hmm. for the ID project. And so that's going to be a total of over 22 billion pesos for the last 5 years. So I questioned that. And that's when I found out the former head of this project, the deputy, what they call the deputy national statistician, had resigned or retired. And I pointed out that the president should now find an able replacement. Mm-hmm. And second, we should do a contract review of the relevant contracts of this project.
Mm-hmm. And sir, how do you recommend a new chief go about addressing this problem aside from the new contracts and the digitalization, perhaps, of the IDs and the changing of the chief? I mean, is the government's target of 92 million cards delivered by June 2023 even feasible?
Given the historical delays, mm-hmm. They probably will not meet the target. What's important is the president, NEDA Secretary Balisakan, should come up with a deadline. Let's say next month. If they're not able to meet that deadline, because they keep on promising, then the contracts should be terminated. Second, we have now new people at the DICT, the Department of ICT. From what I know, these guys are techies. DICT should get involved with PSA because they're part of the council, and find an ICT solution. I think the best thing that they can do is to consider, just like in other parts of the world, a digital ID. Because if they come up with a system that can do a digital ID on your phone, right? You don't need to print it.
Yes, it would be more accessible to everyone in such a shorter amount of time.
So. Correct. It'll probably be cheaper. It'll be faster. Mm-hmm. Because you can now use your phone to come up with your ID. And I don't even know why they didn't do that in the first place. Because that's mm-hmm. what I had thought back then would be done.
Mm. And sir, as for records of the Commission on Audit, PhilSys contractor AllCard has only delivered 27.3 million ID cards as of December last year, which obviously falls below the 36 million annual delivery requirement. Is the contractor not to blame? And the PSA is now using more machines to increase the threshold of printed physical cards. Do you think this will help greatly in addressing the problem, at least now?
I'm not optimistic. I think the government, BSP and PSA, should probably assess what we call liquidated damages. Pag delayed ka sa contract performance, there has to be penalties. So PSA should announce if they've assessed liquidated damages. They should share with the public if they're taking strong action. Second, okay, they added IDs, but I still don't think they'll meet the targets. And third, if you see online, there's so many complaints. The pictures, after a few days, are getting erased. Nabubura. I mean, they're substandard IDs. Even in my area, in Northern Samar, I've had complaints. Even in Congress, Nikki, we have staff who've gotten their IDs who are complaining. Very substandard pictures. The quality is really not good.
Right. And so it's also important to point out now that the total of 28.4 billion has been allotted for the PhilSys project, but only 6.8 billion has been appropriated since 2018, as mentioned before. Where do you think these funds are going, since we've been mentioning the lack of transparency?
That's correct. There's two issues there. First, there's so many good projects and programs that we can fund. Congress can fund, right? We funded this project, the ID system, and they haven't used most of it. That's one issue. Mm-hmm. Second, of the total available, what we call total available appropriations, okay? They've obligated about 13 or 14 billion pesos of that 28. 6 billion was disbursed, meaning already given, over 6 billion pesos have been given out to the various contractors, and they're still delayed. There's about another 7 billion that remains to be paid. I hope they won't do that, because there's no accomplishments, and the IDs are substandard. Mm-hmm. So there's so many issues. That's why I'm calling on PSA and NADA and PSP to do a contract review, and then they should announce to the public the specific provisions of the contracts. Have the contractors fulfilled? Have they assessed liquidated damages? And will they recommend contract termination? That's the normal review, and the public has the right to know. Other than the issue that the president should find someone to lead this project, and once and for all, find the right person to do it.
And Congressman Daza, looking at the funds appropriated by the Congress for the ID project, it's at over 2 billion now for 2023. You know, that's in addition to the unliquidated funds. Is this amount in the first place reasonable? You've since said that if PSA did their work well 2 years ago, we could have saved so much money, right?
Now, I don't agree with the amount. In fact, I think we should zero it. They have available funds for 2022. Nikki, meaning the funds are there for this year, they haven't used. So why fund another 2 billion pesos 2023? It will be a waste of money, I think.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for joining us this morning, Congressman Daza. You stay safe. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Have a nice day.
The Energy Regulatory Commission urges Meralco to protect its consumers should San Miguel Corporation terminate their contract. This following the ERC's decision to reject a joint petition of the two companies seeking a temporary 30 centavo per kilowatt hour rate hike. The ERC says Meralco should look for other remedies to avoid price adjustments.
Siyempre, ang iniisip namin bottom line yung rate impact sa consumer. Ang sa amin lang sa majority ay may provision yung mga kontrata na maaari pa nating i-explore para hindi mangyari yung kinatatakutan. Gawin muna natin yon.
For the National Association of Electricity Consumers for Reforms, Meralco has the responsibility to look for other cheap power suppliers.
O kung may mahanap man siya mas mahal, eh sinong tatamaan? Di tayo din? Kasi ipapasa din sa atin.
Papasa yun. Sa atin, oo.
Tama yan. At kapag hindi niya nagawa yan, baka balikan ng gobyerno yung prangkisa niya dahil hindi niya nagagampanan yung dapat niyang gampanan.
Meralco says it will comply with the ERC decision, but it appeals for a swift approval of its emergency power supply agreement to protect consumers from volatile power prices.
They look now at the financial markets. Wall Street rallied for a second straight day Tuesday, rebounding from a painful rout in September, as investors bet the rapid pace of interest rate hikes could moderate soon. The Dow added 825 points, while the S&P 500 posted its biggest single-day rally in 2 years, surging 3%. The tech-heavy Nasdaq outperformed, climbing 3.3%. A notable stock moves, Twitter jumped 22% after Elon Musk changed course again and proposed to go ahead with his original offer to buy the social media giant for $44 billion. Over in Europe, stocks also surged, with the CAC 40 in France advancing 4.2% as bond yields fall and investors assess rate hikes. Here in Asia, markets rose following a smaller-than-expected rate hike from the Reserve Bank of Australia. The PSEI was among the biggest gainers, adding over 200 points to close at 59.87.
Now, here are some economic data releases that we are monitoring this Wednesday. The Philippines will post its September inflation numbers. Consumer prices in the Philippines eased to a two-month low of 6.3% in August as the rise in food and transport costs slowed. The Reserve Bank of New Zealand will announce its latest policy decision. The market has priced in a half-point interest rate bump while giving 29% odds on a 75 basis point increase. And the U.S. and Canada will both come out with the respective trade balance figures for the month of August.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump asks the Supreme Court to intervene in the legal tussle over classified documents seized by the FBI in his Florida home. Trump urges the conservative-dominated court to stay a ruling by the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals that restored access to the classified documents to the Justice Department. A special master had been appointed to screen the seized files for materials potentially subject to attorney-client privilege. The appellate panel, however, ruled that while the review was ongoing, government should be able to continue using documents marked as classified for its criminal investigation. Trump nominated three of the justices on the nine-member Supreme Court, but it has delivered him several defeats in high-profile cases, most notably by refusing to hear his claims of fraud in the 2020 presidential election.
An ancient Philippine script now on showcase in San Francisco, and history is made in the Miss USA pageant. Those stories and more from our North America correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Good morning, guys. Here are the latest stories making headlines in the Filipino community.
We begin in British Columbia, Canada, where a record number of Filipinos are running for city council posts for the October 15 municipal elections. Amy Peacock, a longtime community organizer, is one of five. She said it's time for the seats in the council to reflect the diverse communities of Vancouver.
You are good enough, and you have a voice, and you have the credibility to put your name and run.
Like fellow city council candidate Lena Vargas, Peacock is also running as an independent. Meanwhile, Maita Santiago, who's running for the Burnaby City Council, urged Filipino Canadians to make their voices heard by electing fellow Filipinos to public office.
Dahil ang gusto po natin ay makita, it's for Burnaby, for the powers that be, to say no more that the Filipinos are an invisible community.
Aside from Peacock, Vargas, and Santiago, the two other Filipino-Canadian candidates in the municipal elections are Narima de la Cruz and Ramon Bandong Jr., both seeking city council posts in Surrey. Let's go to the Philippine Consulate in San Francisco at this ribbon-cutting ceremony that launched the month-long exhibit featuring the pre-colonial ancient Filipino script by Bayin.
I want to show the world that our ancestors were literate. They knew how to read, how to write. So regardless of if they were young, they were children, they were women, they were men.
Through this exhibition, we're hoping, of course, to promote Baybayin and, you know, for Philippine arts, Philippine culture, Philippine history, you know, to be widely known to our Filipino-American community.
And finally, history was made at the 2022 Miss USA in Reno, Nevada Monday night when 28-year-old Arboni Gabriel from Houston became the first Filipina-American to win the prestigious pageant.
Everything has been so fast-paced. I mean, day after day, it's training every day. And sometimes I can't stop and think about it and just realize how amazing this opportunity is. But when I do look at the crown, it just reminds me of all the hard work and dedication that I've put into myself. And it's just a really great feeling.
Gabriel was an early favorite, bagging the Best State Costume Award in the preliminary competition, designed by Patrick Isurena from Quezon City, Philippines. The outfit featured more than 5,000 stones and blue fabrics meant to represent Texas's state flower, the blue bonnet. Gabriel also designed much of her attire for the competition. Her outfit during the question and answer portion used patterns from her mother's wedding dress and the traditional Maria Clara collar shape. With her success, Gabriel wants to inspire fellow Filipinas.
I would encourage women, Filipina Americans too, that they can pave the way to their own success.
And those were the latest from North America. You can catch our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to you guys for the rundown.
And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel. Like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.